Hello, and welcome. I'm Daughter of Darkness, your narrator. Have your plans in life ever been derailed by the green-eyed monster? Well, that is the story I'll be presenting here tonight. But this isn't a tale of jealousy. Rather, the torment that one of my listeners went through at the claws of an actual green-eyed monster. If you have a story that you'd like to submit for possible inclusion in a future video, my email and subreddit are listed below and at the end of the video. But for now, sit back, relax, let me lead the way, and let's get scared together, together, together. In 2009, my wife Dawn and I moved to El Paso, Texas. We both found work, she at an import office for customs, and me as a night dispatcher for a border truck crossing. We also found a great deal on an apartment. The complex where we lived was called the Cielo Vista Apartments, and thankfully, they were torn down in 2018, because it was at that apartment that our nightmares began. As soon as we moved in, we started feeling cold spots throughout the place, and the smells. Out of nowhere, the scent of rot and the grave would show up at the most random of times. We called the maintenance man, thinking that it was a sewer leak or even that we may have a dead animal in the walls, but nothing was ever found. Our first encounter with the spirit came on one hot July day. A man came to our door wearing a heavy winter coat, old khakis, a button-up shirt, and a trilby hat. He looked like something from a different era entirely. Add to that the fact that he was dressed for winter in July, and you can understand why we were a little put off by this guy. He introduced himself as our neighbor and offered us a six-pack of beer as a housewarming gift, but apparently only if he could come inside. The beer itself was not in the modern cans, but in those old cans with a pull tab that they stopped making nearly 3 decades earlier. This was one of many red flags he was raising. He asked us if we were new to the neighborhood, where we were from, and other standard questions. But he also kept trying to get us to invite him inside the apartment in an almost desperate and pushy manner. It was clear he really wanted to get inside. Being polite people, yet not wanting to let this strange man into our home, Dawn and I spoke to him at the door for about 20 minutes before finally telling him that we needed to be somewhere else and excusing ourselves. That whole time, though, he never once gave us his name or told us anything at all about himself. We told him we could talk another time, and he reluctantly took his beer and left. As he turned the corner, I decided to tail him to see where he lived. But upon my turning that same corner just seconds later, he had already vanished. There was no sign of him whatsoever. The path that he took led to a busy neighborhood crossroads, so it was impossible for him to have gone into another apartment in that short amount of time. We wanted to write him off as just a kooky neighbor, but after asking around, we found out that he didn't match any description of anyone who lived in the complex. After that encounter with the weird beer man, the manifestations started to slowly unfold. Every morning at precisely 8 a.m., we would hear 3 loud knocks on the door. When we'd look through the peephole, we'd see nothing. Then, we'd open the door expecting to see a kid laughing and running away, but there would be no one there. This happened every single day until we moved out 2.5 years later. Then, the voices started. Dawn and I would both hear them at the same time, coming from empty rooms. At first, we thought it was just thin walls, but the apartment next to us was vacant, and the other wall faced out to an empty yard, so we ruled that out. We also began having the feeling of being watched at all times, and we'd catch fleeting glimpses of shadow people now and then. Over time, though, the glimpses got longer, and the shadows became more solid. For a short time, though, we also had a pretty fun haunting, the spirit of a Jack Russell dog. It was a faint shadow of a dog that we would encounter at random times during our day. It would appear and disappear in mere seconds, and even friends and family had seen it. We named it Lillian and called it our phantom pet dog. We knew we were being haunted, and we were over the moon at first because we loved ghost hunting shows and scary movies. Our elation turned to horror soon enough, though, as the manifestations grew darker and more sinister. It was around this time that our 17-year-old goddaughter, Sunny, arrived to stay with us for a few weeks. Her mother was on another one of her infamous alcohol benders, and she just needed a place to stay for a while. After Sunny arrived, the weirdness in the apartment amped up. Not only were we dealing with the ongoing disembodied voices, mystery stenches, and the phantom dog, but now our things were being moved. We'd set things down in one place only to have them disappear and reappear at very odd locations. Like, for instance, finding the remote control in the freezer, or my glasses in the teapot. Then one day, Sunny was cleaning the bathroom, and she tossed a handful of paper towels in the toilet and flushed them, causing the toilet to overflow badly. The resulting flood was quite a mess. It went through the entire bathroom and into the closet. It was while cleaning up this mess that I found, hidden in the closet behind a built-in hamper, a small, mysterious locked door. I asked the apartment manager about that door, and he said it contained access to the water main for the entire second level of the building. They sent maintenance to open it so that we could use the shop vac to clean all of the water out. While cleaning, we hit the back of the wall in the access room with the vacuum nozzle, and it moved. It was a false wall that led to yet another part of the pipe room. The hidden room had rotting carpet, a stack of Look magazines from the 1960s, an ancient-looking plate and fork, and some crayon drawings on the exposed wooden beams. The drawings were faded, but from what we could tell, they looked like they were outdoor scenery, like hills, trees, and the sun. The entrance behind the hamper was about 3 feet by 4 feet, and the hidden room itself was 5 feet by 5 feet, not accounting for the extra space that easily went back another few yards. It surprised all of us finding that secret room because nobody knew that it existed. The place was built in 1958 and had been upgraded and added to over time, yet no one knew of this particular space. The secret room became sort of a novelty. I took photos of it on my cell, but unfortunately, due to changing phones about a million times since then, they've been lost. It was after the discovery of that room that our phantom dog left us, and the evil entities came out in force. It started with small things. The voices became more pronounced. They were of an older male and a young female, having very heated conversations. At first, we couldn't make out the words. Then, disturbing mouth-smacking noises could be heard. It sounded like they were either open-mouth chewing or sloppily kissing. This would be heard especially in the bathroom at night. The appearance of the shadow figures became more frequent, and they would stay visible for longer periods of time. And one in particular had green, glowing eyes, and he seemed very sinister. He first appeared on the day after that hidden room was found and opened up. He looked vaguely humanoid. Think of a stretched-out oval standing roughly 6 feet tall, with barely visible limbs and scowling eyes lit up like a green flashlight that had a low battery. It was at this time that the physical attacks began. We were pushed, pinched, and would wake up with painful scratches and marks that looked like electrical burns on our skin. Soon after that, Dawn and I started having night terrors at least once a week. Neither of us ever had a history of them, but they soon became a regular occurrence. We would each wake up in a cold sweat from a terrible dream. The dreams always had the same theme. The apartment was burning down, and for some reason, I would kill her, then commit suicide. Or she would kill me, then commit suicide herself. And the manner of the murders in the dreams became more disturbing and violent with each passing week. Around this time, we also started having money troubles that neither of us could explain. We both had well-paying jobs, but out of nowhere, we had unexplained money issues. Add to that the lack of sleep and the night terrors, and the paranormal phenomena just kept feeding off of our unrest and getting worse and worse. Little did we know at the time, it was barely the beginning. A lot of this seemed to center around Sunny when she was there. When Sunny first arrived and we told her that we were haunted, she sneered and said, "Ghosts aren't real." Seconds later, a multitude of voices called out from the empty bedroom, repeating the words, "Ghosts aren't real," in a mocking manner. She changed her tune after that. Sunny's life was taking a downward spiral at the time. Her depression over her mother's drinking was growing, and she would complain of feeling eyes watching her everywhere she went, to the point that she became paranoid. The shadow people were now normal, everyday occurrences. They would run the gamut from appearing for a few seconds, then going up in a puff of smoke, to sometimes appearing as flesh and blood, solid creatures that could actually reach out and touch you. Then the mimics showed up. They would imitate our voices and call out, trying to lure us into different parts of the apartment. I heard Dawn's voice many times, calling me from that hidden room in the closet, wanting me to join her inside, even though I knew she was at work at the time. And she heard me outside, in the closet, in the bedroom, and other places too. Dawn also started receiving phone calls with that same disgusting lip-smacking sound that we would hear in the bathroom. Once, she even received a phone call from her abusive, deceased mother that left her in tears. The call upset Dawn so much that she never even told me the exact nature of what was said. Now, it may have been the spirit of her mother or something mimicking her mother, but either way, the emotional damage was done just the same. One encounter with a mimic was even seen by people outside of our home. I went to the local bodega to do some grocery shopping one day, and I saw Sunny on the sidewalk along the way. I said hi to her, but she ignored me and kept walking on by. I figured she was just being a bratty teenager, so I blew it off at first. Then I saw her a block later, and again she ignored me. Well, now I was really getting a little upset by her rudeness. I saw her for a third time, right outside the bodega. And for a third time, she ignored me. That's when I went off on her for being rude. Then, what appeared to be Sunny started laughing at me in a voice that sounded like a baby's cry. Then it turned into an agonizing, ear-piercing scream before the entity mimicking Sunny faded away and disappeared right there on the sidewalk. A man inside the bodega started praying out loud and calling out for help from the Virgin of Guadalupe. And another guy on the sidewalk exclaimed, "I ain't never smoking that spice shit again." I was cracking up laughing. Yes, I was able to find the humor in the situation. There was one time when having the green-eyed demon around actually proved beneficial. Sunny and I were walking to the coin-operated laundry one night when some members of a local street gang started hassling us. They were trying their best to scare us when one of them froze, looked past me and said, "Hey man, what the F is that?" I turned around to see old Green Eyes hovering in midair. I turned back around and said to the gang member, "He guards the neighborhood. You want me to introduce you?" After some shouts of "El Diablo," the gang members took off running, and Sunny and I couldn't stop laughing all night. The green-eyed shadow really wasn't a protector, though, as we would soon find out. You might be asking yourself why we didn't just pack up and move and head for the hills. Well, we were broke. I think the unexplained money issues may have been caused by whatever it was in that apartment in an effort to keep us tied there. And it just kept getting bolder and bolder until the entities just didn't seem to care about hiding any longer and let it rip. One night, my wife was away on business and I was in bed alone. Then, something heavy got into bed with me. Now, my wife was in Austin, and the doors and the windows were locked, so I should have been alone. I turned to look, and I saw a red-headed woman lying in bed facing away from me. Dawn was a redhead, but she was in Austin at the time. I also heard a low, growling sound. I just said, "Good night, sweetie," and rolled over and went to sleep. I figured, what's the worst it can do? Kill me? At least that way I'll be able to deal with it on its own level. Luckily, it was gone when I woke up. I never mentioned that experience to Dawn. Another time, when we were watching TV late at night, our appearances started changing. It was like we were hallucinating and our faces were going from young children to old corpses in the blink of an eye. It was around that time that the demonic entities started to make sure that we would not have a support system around us, and they did everything they could to isolate and discredit us with friends, neighbors, and the authorities. Dawn and I had gone out to dinner one night, only to arrive back home to find Sunny, some of our neighbors, and the police at our place. It turns out they had overheard a violent fight between a man and a girl coming from inside of our apartment. We tried to explain that we weren't even home at the time. We weren't arrested, but after that little fiasco, our reputation got damaged and the rumor mill started spinning. Not long after that, the voices started getting louder and clearer, and we were finally understanding who it was and what was going on. They were the spirits of a father and daughter who had lived there before us. Even in death, he was still abusing her, or loving her, as he put it. Yes, he was still molesting her, even in the afterlife. It was then that the loud, sloppy kissing sounds that we heard in the bathroom made more disgusting sense. I don't know if that little hidden room is where he used to go in life to abuse her, or if that's where she would go to hide out. But these two were apparently bound to this world and to the apartment by the green-eyed shadow person that we now think is a demon brought to the apartment by the actions of the father. And we're pretty sure the beer guy, who was oh so insistent on gaining entry to the home, was the molester in question. Maybe that's why things kicked into high gear when Sunny, an attractive young woman, came to stay with us in the apartment. Dawn and I did some digging, and we found that a father and daughter did indeed live in that apartment back in the 1960s. They were both killed in a drunk driving accident, and it was mentioned in newspaper articles. While there were no pictures in the articles, I'm willing to bet anything it was them. In the final weeks that we lived there, before we had saved enough money and were able to leave, the demon waged an all-out assault on us. As it gathered more energy, the demonic entity started to physically hurt us very badly, and it even attempted to kill me. One night, while we were in bed, I awoke to see a black arm coming out of the wall over Dawn's head, and it grabbed her by the hair and slammed her head into the exposed rock wall that made up one entire side of the bedroom. She suffered a severe concussion, and her body was covered in cuts and bruises in the shape of claws. We went to the hospital, and I was investigated for spousal abuse because they saw the marks on her body. After weeks of a legal nightmare and police investigations, we finally got them off our backs. Dawn kept telling them that I did nothing wrong, but they didn't believe her. Eventually, though, they had to drop the case for a lack of evidence. Next came an attempt on my life. I was driving home alone from work in our SUV when something within the car pushed me hard and made me lose control of the vehicle, and it flipped over with me inside. Looking back, I think it was the green-eyed demon that did it. I was lucky, though. I got off with a concussion, 4 broken ribs, and nerve damage to my face that gave me an eye twitch that I still have to this day. The last casualty seems to have been Sunny's mom. She finally drank herself to death, and Sunny blamed us for the longest time because, according to her, we had the devil in our house and it followed her home. She became a religious zealot for a time after that. Finally, we took what little money we had saved up, packed up everything that we hadn't pawned or sold, and ran for the hills. Surprisingly, everything went quiet after the death of Sunny's mom. In hindsight, I wonder if she was sacrificed or something. I really hate thinking that way, though. Anyway, in about a year's time after we left, we went from living in our car and hotels to being back on our feet and doing pretty well. And eventually, we were even able to repair our relationship with Sunny. Unfortunately, Dawn passed away, but from meningitis, not demons. Sunny moved on with her life, and she's now married with 2 kids and lives in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And as for me, I was left stronger than ever after coming out relatively unscathed from Hell's Funhouse. Well, that was quite a ride, wasn't it? I truly believe that everyone has a paranormal tale to tell. So again, if you have one that you would like to submit for a chance to have it narrated on this channel, then you can find my email and my subreddit listed above and in the link below. Thank you all for listening tonight. So, until next time, stay scared, my friends.